This video is about how to make a theoretical contribution. Before you start developing a theoretical framework for your research, you'd better think about how your research can make a theoretical contribution to the field. Empirical research should have a theoretical contribution. At the end of each paper, you are expected to discuss your paper's theoretical contribution. How does your research inform theoretical advances in the field of educational leadership? To answer the question of how, you need to first know whether your research makes a theoretical contribution or not. Theoretical contributions extend, clarify, or apply existing theories in new and interesting ways. This definition of a theoretical contribution can guide you as you evaluate a study's theoretical contributions. Imagine all scholars, both past and present, say X is important in leadership. Here, X can be relationship building, trust, vision, and moral values. You then design a study to prove X is important in leadership in Y context. How much theoretical contribution does your study make? You may justify your work's theoretical contribution by saying your empirical findings indicate that X is important in leadership, particularly in context Y. Let's pause for a moment. The proposition that X is important in leadership implies that X is important in leadership in all contexts. If your study provides empirical evidence that X is important in leadership in Y context, for example, an elementary school, an urban school, a rural school, and a school with a high percentage of economically disadvantaged students, the theoretical contribution of your study is that you offer one more piece of confirming evidence supporting the proposition that X is important in leadership. It is likely your paper will disappear into a black hole of all confirming evidence reported by like-minded people. Here is another scenario. Prior research suggests that X is important in leadership. Instead of designing a study confirming that X is important in leadership in Y context, you read some literature, observe how X works, and have some inkling that X may not work in all contexts. In fact, X has a negative impact on organizational outcome under certain circumstances. You then read more literature to narrow down what specific negative impact under what specific circumstance. To substantiate your claim, you collect and analyze data to see if your claim is supported by empirical evidence. Here is the question: which study has a stronger theoretical contribution? If you are like most people, you choose the latter because it provides you with more understanding of X, not by repeating something you have already known, but by challenging an existing theory and adding something new. Unfortunately, many empirical studies I read fall into the first category. In this video, I'll introduce one of four paths for theoretical contributions you can make in the field of educational leadership. Before outlining the path, a caveat is in order. It is unacceptable for you to simply say that you study X because no literature has addressed X. This is a popular statement you find in many empirical papers. But its ubiquity doesn't make a compelling argument. Just because no one has jumped off a cliff doesn't mean you should do it. Likewise, just because no one has done something doesn't mean you should do it. To justify a theoretical contribution, you need to focus your argument on why X is important. Let's now embark on the first path for making theoretical contributions to our field of educational leadership. The first path is to challenge an existing theory. You read the literature and find something amiss. So you challenge an existing theory without proposing a new theory. Compared to developing a new theory that upends an old theory, this path is a gentle approach to theoretical contribution. Here I use my own conceptual paper as an example. In my paper titled "Is Data-Driven Decision-Making at Odds with Moral Decision-Making?", I challenged an existing theory of data-driven decision-making. When I was a graduate student of educational leadership in 2009, data-driven decision-making was a buzzword. Despite different definitions, data-driven decision-making highlighted a salient role of data in decision-making. Leaders were recommended to make their decisions by collecting, analyzing, and interpreting data. To me, this decision-making approach seems too ideal, but I can't articulate what was wrong exactly. That nagging feeling stayed with me until I started reading literature in psychology and neuroscience. From psychology literature, I learned about information bias. It is people's tendency to seek excessive information when it does not influence decisions. We use less information than we think to form our judgments. More information is not always better. In a study of teacher evaluation, a principal's ratings of a high school teacher's job evaluation were significantly predicted by the judgments of a teacher's nonverbal behavior based on short, silent video clips that were under 30 seconds. Moreover, people sometimes seek information, but other times avoid information. Recently, it was reported that whether people seek or avoid information is subjected to at least three factors. First, how they think information will make them feel. Second, how useful it is. And third, if information relates to things they think about often. And different people assign different weights to those three factors. Feelings are sometimes a better predictor of people's decisions than data or information. From neuroscience literature, I learned about how human brains process information. Dopamine, which is a chemical that transmits messages between neurons, play a role in information seeking. Seeking information, even when the information has no effect on our decisions, has been found to activate the dopaminergic system, making us feel good. We require information based not only on its actual benefit, but also on the anticipation of its benefits. Recently, it was found that obtaining new information can be addictive. An explanation is that seeking new information triggers the brain's dopamine-producing reward system in the same way as financial rewards, food, and drug. For example, food, either nutritious food or junk food, activates the brain regions specifically known to be involved in valuation. Those brain regions include the striatum and ventral medial prefrontal cortex or medial prefrontal cortex. They are part of the dopaminergic reward system. The dopaminergic reward system produces dopamine, making us having pleasurable feelings, but it does not tell whether the system trigger is good or bad, just like nutritious food and junk food. We have the same pleasurable feeling after eating nutritious food and junk food. We have the same pleasurable feeling after taking painkiller or addictive drug. Information triggers our brain's dopaminergic reward system in a similar way. Just like our brains overvalue nutrition from junk food, our brains overvalue information that makes us feel good, but may not be useful. Just like we tend to be addicted to drugs and comfort food, which triggers a surge of dopamine, we tend to be addicted to data and information, which triggers our dopaminergic system in the same way. I also learned about two brain networks that are antagonistic to each other. A brain network is a set of multiple brain regions. In human brains, the default mode network and test positive network work like two ends of a seesaw. When the default mode network is activated, the test positive network is suppressed, and vice versa. The default mode network is activated when we perform tasks involved in emotion processing and social interactions. Making moral decisions involves emotions such as empathy, compassion, gratitude, pride, disgust, guilt, shame, regret, and moral outrage. This is because the purpose of making moral decisions is to promote and stabilize cooperative behaviors dependent upon socially shaped ideas of right and wrong. The emotional and social aspects of moral decision-making explain why making moral decisions activates the decision-maker's default mode network in their brains. By contrast, the test positive network is activated when we perform tasks that demand logical reasoning and causal reasoning. As we fixate our attention on achieving a goal, we tend to be deliberate, analytical, and conduct a cost-benefit analysis, which includes underestimating the cost of using deception as a means to an end. Given the antagonistic relationship between the default mode network and the test positive network, the trade-off between the two brain networks suggests a neural constraint for school leaders who cannot be both genuinely empathetic and analytic at the same time. This neural constraint has substantive implications for school leaders' decision-making. The test positive network, activated by data-driven decision-making, which is an analytically intensive undertaking, might suppress the default mode network, which is needed for leaders to make the decisions to care for others. An overemphasis on leaders being analytical and data-driven, which activates the task-positive network and suppresses the default mode network, may lead to leaders' lack of empathetic and moral concerns for others, whereas an overemphasis on leaders focusing on emotions, caring, being people-centered, which activates the default mode network and suppresses the task-positive network, may lead to the loss of focus on accomplishing clearly defined goals. As a result, data-driven decision-making and moral decision-making might be incompatible at the same time. After sharing my own work of challenging an existing theory, I share an example in a recently published article on leader humility. Leader humility can be defined as willingness to view oneself accurately, for example, accepting their limitations. Second, teachability or openness, for example, seeking feedback, even if it is critical. And third, appreciating the strength and contributions of others, for example, recognizing the achievements of others. A well-established idea in leadership literature is that humility is a virtue that leaders should have. You've probably read somewhere in the literature saying that humility is not weakness. Rather, being humble shows a leader is secure enough to listen to and empower others, which is a powerful way to lead. The more humility a leader demonstrates, the better team performance is. Is it true? Is humility a virtue that has no negative consequence in organizations? In an article titled, A Wolf in Sheep's Clothing, Exploring the Relationship Between Leader Humility and Unethical Behavior, authors challenge the construct of humble leadership and the assumption that being humble is a positive leadership practice. The authors build their argument from moral licensing theory, which refers to the effect that when people initially behave in a moral way, they are later more likely to display unethical behavior. If leaders believe being humble is a morally praiseworthy behavior, they may think their humility has earned them some moral credits in a metaphorical bank account. Those moral credits allowed them to have a license to break bad by engaging in unethical behavior, such as falsifying a receipt to get reimbursement for more money than they spent on business expenses, and misrepresenting the truth to make them look good. To test the argument, the authors asked two research questions. First, does leader humility have a detrimental effect on the behavior of leaders? Second, if so, under what conditions and mechanisms are such detrimental effects likely to emerge? The authors then collected data on theoretical constructs of leader humility, moral credits, and unethical behavior. The results of data analysis supported the argument that leader humility is not all positive, but has a dark side. Science is about challenging assumptions, especially those well-established ones. It is about screening facts from fiction and wishful thinking. Challenge an existing theory, and you may be able to blow the field of educational leadership wide open. In this video, I introduced the first path for making a theoretical contribution. It is to challenge an existing theory. I will continue to introduce the rest of three paths for making a theoretical contribution in the next three videos.